Hello everyone, I am Preeti from Francis Xavier Engineering College of 2020 batch from ECE department. Education is the key to success in life and teachers makes a lasting impact in the lives of their students. Really, I am grateful to all faculties and placement training team. Because of their restless effort, so many students have been placed. Yeah, I have also been placed in MindGate and VINDAR. All the credits goes to our faculties who motivated us to achieve this. I welcome you all to today's webinar, Discover the New Trends in Industries. This webinar is organized by the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering from Francis Xavier Engineering College, Tirunelveli, in association with Francis Xavier Alumni Association. Now, I request Dr. A. Andrew Robert, Assistant Professor of ECE, to give welcome address. Sir, thanks for being a good mentor and for guiding us on a right path. Over to Andrew, sir.
Good morning, everyone. In this moment, I would like to welcome our head of the department, Professor J. Friska, madam. Then our resource person, Engineer A. Clayton George Paul, IT analyst TCS Chennai, who is an alumnus of our department in the 2014 batch. Then I would like to welcome the Director of the Alumni Association, Mr. Krishna Kumar sir, and another coordinator of this event, Mr. S. Isaki Rajavel sir, who is an Assistant Professor of our ECE department. Then I would like to welcome all the participants to this event. I request all of you to attend this event till the end. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Every day may not be good, but there is something good in every day. So let's start the session with prayer.
Prayer. Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you and praise you, Father, for this wonderful day you have given to look to your face. We thank you for all your blessings and guidance in the past days of our life. Lord Jesus, at the start of this new day, we all have gathered here to listen to your voice. Lord Jesus, we especially commit this program in your mighty hands. From the beginning till the end, let your presence and divine guidance be with us. We especially pray for our alumni, Clayton George Paul. Bless him, fill him with your divine knowledge and wisdom. We especially pray for all the participants. We pray for the organizers. Lord Jesus, from the beginning till the end, let your Holy Spirit take entire control. We commit this program in your mighty hands, guide us and lead us. We ask all these things in the most precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Her positivity and encouragement brighten our days. She is none other than our HOD, Professor J. Friska, ma'am, Department of ECE. I request her to share few words. Over to Friska, ma'am.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make straight your paths. Respected speaker of today's alumni webinar series 3, Engineer A. Clayton George Paul, alumnus of 2014 batch, IT analyst, TCS Chennai, learned professors, students, the future of our nation, coordinators of today's event, my dear faculty friends, participants who have joined with us for today's session on discovering the new trends in industries, a very fine morning to one and all. Electronics and communication engineering is the utilization of science and math applied to practical problems in the field of communication. Can we imagine our daily life without mobile phones, a laptop, computer, television, tablets, digital watches, internet banking, ATM cards, Wi-Fi, internet connection, microwave ovens, many more gadgets and communication systems? No, we cannot. All these are possible due to electronics and communication engineering. As we look into the future, robots will also be part of our lives very soon. Embedded electronics, which is a sub-branch of electronics, play an important role in this. We feel happy to say that Francis Xavier Engineering College, Department of ECE, an award for industry-ready professional. Our campus is a multicultural campus with excellent infrastructure and the facilities which facilitates a congenial learning atmosphere. We have holistic association with Texas Instruments, National Instruments, Weekend Pro Incubation Center, Dell EMC Square, VMware, Cisco, Palo Alto Networks, and so on. Francis Xavier Engineering College Alumni Association is a forum to establish a link between alumni and our institution. The students of our college pursue not only their graduation, but also hunt their dreams. They are dynamic professionals, successful entrepreneurs with great passion, with ethics and values. We feel extremely delighted in sharing that we have 7,000 plus alumni spread across the globe, which is a significant milestone. In establishing a connection with our alumni and current students, they can gain access to wider professional networks, exclusive job listings, targeted career services, connect with the community, and socializing. Our alumni also get the satisfaction that they are connected to us and help the future generation of alumni have the same opportunities and positive experiences they did. Today's event is one such initiative. We are extremely delighted to hear from our alumnus of 2014 batch, Engineer A. Clayton George Paul, who is a hardworking, sincere, a kind-hearted alumni. I don't want to take much of your time. So with this, I would like to conclude my speech. Thank you one and all.
Thank you, ma'am, for your fabulous words. Now, I would like to call upon my friend Kirtiga to give introduction about our chief guest. Over to Kirtiga.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Kirtiga from Francis Xavier Engineering College 2020 batch of Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering. It's my great pleasure to introduce our resource person, Engineer A. Clayton George Paul, IT analyst, TCS Chennai, who is an alumni of 2014 batch of ECE department, and also he is a secretary of 2014 ECE Stursy. He worked as a MQ administrator with Tech Mahindra since 2015 to 2017. He is currently pursuing his career in TCS as MQ administrator. He has 5.6 years of work experience as a WebSphere MQ administrator. His achievements include receiving Bravo Award for Project Excellence in Tech Mahindra and Patton Back Award from Mars Client and receiving on Spot Award from Morgan Stanley. He has skilled in ITSM processes and service management. He has configured and created MQ objects like queue managers, remote queries, local queues, and queue analysis. He has an extensive experience on configuration and monitoring the MQ listeners, channel initiators, trigger monitors, MQ log files, and letter queues. He also expertise in performing the backup and recovery of the MQ objects, upgradation and migration of the MQ series. His knowledge extends to the multi-installation part of 7.1 to 7.5 versions and to the SSL concepts. He has a great ability in quick understanding and planning of new technologies and their applications to business solutions. Thank you very much, sir, for joining with us today. Therefore, we will listen to the webinar and learn many new ideas and clarify our doubts with them. Thank you, one and all. May I now invite Engineer Clayton George Paul, IT analyst, TCS Chennai, alumnus of 2014 batch, to share his experience with us. Over to Chief Guest Engineer Clayton George Paul.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. It was really overwhelming. Thanks for your warm welcome. Let me share my screen. Very good morning to you all. Here I'm gonna tell you the recent technology trends that you have to be aware of. Let me introduce myself in very short. I'm an alumni of 2014 batch pass out from Francis Xavier Engineering College, and currently I work for an IT company. And I'm basically from a middleware background, where I happen to work on middleware technologies such as IBM MQ, web, methodologies, brokers, and even integration platform. Say in simple, in layman language, I would say it's kind of a integration platform. In addition to that, I would say that I'm still a novice. In the sense, like I'm a good beginner who has embarked the venture towards learning. In other words, in this today's session, I want you to look at the key technology trends in today's business. Let me share the screen. We'll discuss on the first trend I would like to talk about today. The trend is artificial intelligence as a service. As you are aware of how artificial intelligence and machine learning completely transforming our world nowadays, what we are seeing is the companies are starting to apply this technology, that is artificial intelligence as a service. Please make note of that word, as a service. You have to understand what artificial intelligence and what's the process. As a service is a separate term that we could like discuss later in this session. And this starting to change the business. However, what we see is that lots of business still see developing their own artificial intelligence infrastructure as a really expensive proposition. So what is happening now is that more and more organizations use AI as a service. This basically means customers would now go to companies like Google, Amazon, Microsoft, or simply say they would like to apply artificial intelligence to their processes as they have got some data. These companies, such as I mentioned earlier, Google, Amazon, or big tech companies would in turn use the customers' data to train their machine learning algorithms. And they could then supply the algorithms. And this is a massive trend. And even they could supply the infrastructure as well. And customers simply pay as a service. So they don't have to pay for overall requirement what they needed. Rather, they could like pay for only what they really wanted to do in terms of artificial intelligence. So this is a massive trend nowadays. And artificial intelligence in general will make a big impact on business. We would get used to working alongside in upcoming years. And it is, but in particular, this is a service offering would make a really, really big differences to companies as well. So we will discuss the next trend. Emerging trend, that is 5G. As you are all aware of, this is basically the fifth generation of mobile networks. So this means you have probably seen the evolution from 3G to 4G basically has given us fast connectivity on our mobile phones. On 4G, we can now easily watch videos, whereas what 5G will do is that it will accelerate its speeds at a very faster rate. Similar to what we have in terms of high-speed internet connections into our homes and into our businesses. It would also reduce the latency. So everything would be a lot faster and it would make those connections more reliable. This has huge implications on not only what we would have mobile phones that are 5G enabled, that would easily stream music and videos, but also for business, especially connecting machinery for self-driving cars. And all of these devices are also known as, we call it as Internet of Things nowadays. Smart devices need reliable, fast connectivity to push data towards, forwards and backwards from the cloud. And 5G, of course, is gonna make massive difference with all of this. What we are currently seeing is starting that it could be rolled out. So we could see this is in inner cities of major capitals. We could see this is in confined areas, but in coming months or coming years, we would see much wider coverage, and we would even see costs of 5G connectivity would definitely be going down. So we would not have only better connected homes, offices, or we would could simply use the 5G network, have amazingly fast and reliable internet connectivity everywhere, and be able to transfer data everywhere. And so as a business futurist, you guys, I mean, even if you could help business understand what this means, and the 5G is one area that we should be looking at, and it's very extensively with lots of businesses, helping them to understand what 5G means and to offer completely a new product and services in order to improve the businesses or companies, the internal processes connecting to machines and things like predictive maintenance. So of course, 5G is another major or massive trend we ought to look at. Okay, I would suggest you two guys to explore more on these trends. Okay, let's move on to the third trend I would like to talk about today is autonomous driving. Again, this is a trend, the future of transport and autonomous driving. As you might have known, like Elon Musk, the CEO of Tesla, has basically said that by end of 2020, again, this year, he would have his horse, the Teslas, would completely be autonomous. And hopefully we would see those cars would be on the road, being able to drive anywhere completely and autonomously. Currently, we have been seeing lots of issues around the regulations. Of course, there would be downside, lots of issues around infrastructure. But again, if 5G comes along, we won't have those infrastructure issues anymore. Again, this page is purely subjective. It's not objective, so it might vary. The perspective might vary. And we could see self-driving cars everywhere. Of course, hand in hand, if 5G gets along with these autonomous technology, of course, we would see the self-driving cars everywhere. And when we talk about autonomous driving, it's not just completely a self-driving cars, and also that we have seen evolution towards it. So steps are being taken. For example, we now have cars that have lane assistance. So they would watch where you are driving, and they help you to switch lanes. And cars that would brake automatically. And even we have cars that detect hazards. So this is gonna like to happen more and more again. It's not just cars. We now have self-driving ships also, self-flying drones, and even robot deliveries. So currently, in Western countries, they have their Starship robots that is now delivering Amazon parcels as a local shopping. So of course, we would see more autonomous driving as a massive trend henceforth. Again, it's my advice. You guys need to explore more on autonomous driving. It's based on your interest. You can explore more. Let's move on to the fourth trend I would like to talk about today is predictive and precision analytics, especially in the field of medicine. As we are currently seeing, this is a complete transformation of healthcare and medicine, where technology is making a really big difference. So recent advances in Internet of Things, technology has smarter devices in addition to artificial intelligence and some real breakthroughs in genomics. which means that we can now have much more predictive capabilities. I would like to quote an instance. Just think about things like the Apple Watch. Now it has recently been an article, I have read it in an article that the Apple Watch could potentially extend someone's life by 2 years. Because it can monitor their heart conditions, as it could generate warnings and alarms, and this is gonna happen more and more, that we would have more smart devices helping to monitor us, our health conditions, and we would have the developments in genomics as well that helps us to target treatments specifically to us. So the healthcare system, doctors will be able to detect what your genetic makeup is, and they could even find treatments using this predictive and precision analytics. That would work best for us delivering the best outcomes as an individual. And we may see again massive advances. So again, some of the latest trends and medicine in healthcare, one could always explore more. And again, I would suggest you to explore more on predictive and precision analytics with regard to the field of medicine. Having said that, like you, I would like to move on to the next trend I would like to talk about today is the computer vision. Okay, I would like to explain this in a layman language. Again, we are seeing a real acceleration in this trend at the moment, where we know how amazing capabilities of machines that are able to recognize what is on a photograph. They could now recognize things in video footage. And obviously, we have face recognition capability, which is really making a huge impact. We now have devices like latest phones that use face ID. So basically, a face recognition scan allow you to, of course, it would allow you to lock and unlock the mobile screens on in terms of security, but new advances with regard to this trend, that is a computer vision, these are allowing the companies that operate taxi operators. They are using, say for example, taxi operators, Didi, Uber, they're using face recognition technology in the vehicle to recognize drivers and for both security purposes and billing purposes. See, they have, it has a huge impact on businesses as well. we have seen this in Amazon trial zones. I'm not quite sure whether we have this technology here in our country, but in Western countries and the other developed countries, where they use a face recognition technology to monitor who you are, and then what you are actually buying. And these technologies would fetch the data of you, who you are, in fraction of seconds. So you, as a customer, they want the cameras would watch and what the consumers are putting into your shopping bags. I mean, their shopping bags. And simply walk out. If consumers are simply walk out, the system would charge you appropriately. So this is the technology that would evolve, again, I'm reiterating this once again, that would definitely evolve very fast in forthcoming years, and is something everyone should keep tap on it. I'd like to talk about next trend, I would like to talk about the next trend, that is nothing but extended reality. I'll keep it short. Extended reality is basically what we are seeing in three different types. We see a virtual reality where we completely immerse ourselves into the digital world using headsets, or we even have augmented reality that would be overlaid things on the real world using computer screens or glasses. And of course, we have mixed reality as well. That would be overlaid a digital object into the real world like a hologram, and we are able to interact with this. And what we have recently seen is this, that technology is evolving so fast in this space. I'll quote an instance. Microsoft has just released their latest HoloLens, a mixed reality headset that is probably leading edge. We are seeing augmented reality being used by companies to try things out. Of course, I have recently gone through a few articles on this, knowing more about how companies like Rolex, they are now using this technology, that is the extended reality technology, to allow you to use your phone screen to basically try out Rolex watches using augmented reality. And I would say Lenskart, they are using this technology, they are using this extended reality technology to trial their products, eyeglasses, by using our screens, by using our tabs or mobiles or our computer monitors. See how the technology is emerging. This is how, this is the whole idea of try before you buy. Again, the future is gonna be like this. Of course, it would be like this. You would not need to go to a shop to try for a shirt or whatever. It would be a extended reality. It would of course make a big impact on businesses and would definitely go mainstream in upcoming years. Hopefully, yes. So again, that would be my advice. You guys would need to do some research on extended reality, virtual reality, augmented reality. So you'd be able to get to know how things work, how these businesses are running, how these businesses are making huge, profit. Having said that, I would like to move on to the next trend, which I would like to talk about today is blockchain technology. I'll keep it in short. In the news, we hear a lot about Bitcoin, and it's, of course, the price is going up and down when we talk about blockchain. We don't necessarily talk about the Bitcoin cryptocurrency. Rather, we could talk about the business applications of blockchain. And lots of those are probably not traditional blockchains. They are more, I call it as distributed ledgers. So they're not completely distributed, but they are being run by a number of companies. So we do have the benefits of blockchain technology, but not necessarily, as there are some of the downsides as well. And what we have seen in this year is that companies like FedEx and companies like Walmart and MasterCard are heavily investing into blockchain technology. And then, of course, in upcoming years, we would see the launch of Facebook's Libra cryptocurrency coin, I guess. Again, a collaboration with other organizations like Uber and Spotify, and that would all be part of this. And that would be all part of this blockchain technology. It might happen. So we would see blockchain technology as a major technology trend as well. And again, you could explore tons of articles explaining all the backgrounds on blockchain. And of course, I believe that every business and every individual really needs to get to grips with these emerging trends. And I have three more trends to talk about. And I would like to move on to the next trend. That is nothing but the data science. You know, everyone is like, we have been like encountering this term data science, across everywhere. So this is nothing but our ability to learn and get better at tasks through experience. It's part of being human. In other words, when we are born, we know almost nothing and we could do almost nothing for ourselves. But soon we would learn and become more capable every day. But do you know that computers can do the same? Machine learning brings together statistics and computer science to enable computers to learn how to do a given task without being programmed to do so. Please make note of it. Computers to learn how to do a given task without being programmed to do so. It's just like our brain uses our brain uses our experiences to improve a task, so can computers. Say you need a computer that can tell the difference between a picture of a dog and a picture of a cat. You could begin by feeding its images and telling it this one's a dog and the other one's a cat. A computer program, in order to learn, it would seek statistical patterns within the data that would enable it to recognize a cat or dog in the future. It might figure out on its own that cats have shorter noses and dogs come in a larger variety of sizes, and then represent that information numerically, organizing its space. But crucially, it's a computer. Again, it's a computer, not the programmer, that identifies those patterns and establishes the algorithm by which future data would be sorted out. One example of simple, I'd like to quote an instance here, yet highly effective algorithm is to find the optimal line separating cats from dogs. See, when the computer sees a new picture, it checks which side of the line it falls on, or then says either cat or dog. See, I'm speaking it quick technically. I'll keep it short, but of course there could be mistakes. The more the data you feed, the computer receives, the more it tunes itself very finely. The algorithm, it has its own algorithm, it tunes itself very finely. It predicts the more accurate in its predictions. Machine learning is already widely applied here. Is the technology behind the facial recognition, text-to-speech recognition, spam filters on your inbox, online shopping, comes to e-commerce department, or viewing recommendations, credit card fraud detections, and so much more. We can tell a lot. At the University of Oxford, machine language researchers are combining statistics and computer science to build algorithms that could solve more and more complex problems more efficiently using less computing power. From medical diagnosis to social media, the potential of machine language to transform our world would definitely be a mind-blowing. And again, this field, of course, everyone has to keep tab on it. And you guys really should explore what the data science is, what this trend is, and how it gets projected, and how it's get, again, implementing in a real-time world. And again, I have got two more trends to talk about today. It's a ninth trend. Let's move on to the next slide. There is machine learning. Please listen carefully. data science, machine learning, and the next trend which I'm going to talk about is cloud computing. Definitely it's going to play a vital role in future, so please listen carefully. We hear a lot about the artificial intelligence and machine learning are going to change the world, and how the Internet of Things, IoT, will make everyone's life easier. But what's the one thing that underpins all of these revolutionary technologies? The answer is data. See, data, it's vital, it's crucial. From social media to the IoT devices for generating, say, bill amount of data, consider the cab services provided to Uber. I'm sure all of you have used Uber, of course, or if not Uber, you have used Ola or whatever. See, what are you think makes that Uber or Ola a multi-billion dollar worth company? It is that availability of cabs. Or in other words, is it their service? Well, the answer is data. Again, the data makes them grow higher and higher. It gives the profit to the Uber and Ola. The answer is, of course, the data. But wait, is there anything enough to grow business? It isn't. You must know how to use the data to draw useful insights and solve problems. This is where data science comes. In other words, data science is the process of using data to find solution to predict outcomes for a problem statement, to better understand data science. Let's see how it affects our day-to-day activities. Let's say it's a Monday morning and I have to get to office before my meeting starts. So I quickly open up Uber or Ola and look for cabs, but there's something unusual. Comparatively higher at this hour of the day. Why does this happen? Well, obviously, because Monday mornings are peak hours, let's say, and everyone's rushing off to work. The high demand for cabs leads to increase in the cab fares as well. We all know this, but now, how all this is implemented, data science is at heart of Uber's and Ola pricing algorithms. The search pricing algorithm ensures that their passengers always get a ride when they need one. Even if it comes at the cost of inflated prices, Uber implements data science to find out which neighborhoods will be the busiest, or the Ola find out which neighborhood would be the busiest so that it could activate search pricing to get more drivers on the search pricing let the more drivers on the road. In this manner, it has been over maximized. The number of rides it could provide and hence benefit from this Uber understanding the business requirement or the problem. That's how a data science process always begins with. If you're trying to solve in the case, the business requirement is to build a dynamic pricing model that takes effect. When a lot of people in the same area are requesting rides at the same time, of course, it happens. I'd like to add a few more points with regard to this data science, and this is followed by a data collection. Say, for example, Uber collects data such as weather, Oracle data, holidays times, or traffic pickups and drop locations, and it keeps a track of all this. The next stage is data cleaning. While sometimes unnecessary data is collected, such data only increases the cafes or caches nearby. Now, such data is not needed to analyze. So what companies would do, these Uber or Ola search pricing, mitigate this data and remove this data by using these data cleaning processes. And they would also do some exploration and analysis. This is where you understand the patterns in the data. This is again followed by data modeling. The data modeling, which involves building a machine learning model that predicts these Uber's or Ola's search at a given time and location as well. This model is built by using all the insights and trends collected in the exploration stage. You would have to make note of what are the stages here. The model is trained by feeding thousands of customer records so that it can learn to predict the outcome more precisely. Next stage would be the data validation stage. Here, the model is tested when a new customer books arrive. The data by new booking is compared with the historic data in order to check if there are any anomalies in the search prices or any false predictions. If any such anomalies are detected, a notification is immediately sent to the data scientists at Uber or Ola. I'm just portraying Uber and Ola as an example. It could be any organization, it could be an e-commerce sector, it could be a medical sector, whatever sector it could be, there would be a data scientist available. Who fixes this issue? This is how Uber and Ola predicts a search price of a given location and time the final stage of the science is deployed and optimized. So after testing the model and improving its efficiency, it is deployed on all the users. At this stage, customer feedback is received, and if there are any issues, again, please listen carefully. If there are any issues, they're fixed here. So that was the entire data science process. Now let's look at the few other applications of data science where data science is really implemented. In e-commerce platforms like Amazon and Flipkart, it is also the logic behind Netflix recommendation system. Now in all actuality, quality data science has made remarkable changes in today's market. Its application range from credit card fraudulent detection or self-driving cars or even virtual assistant such as Siri or Alexa. So we can tell n number of examples with regard to this. Let's consider an example. Suppose you look for shoes in Amazon, but you do not buy it then and there. Now the next day you are watching videos on YouTube and suddenly you see an ad for the same item you looked in the YouTube that it's popping in the Facebook. Also, you see the same and see, you should ask why, how suddenly you see this ad for the same item you switch to the Facebook there. How does this happen? Well, this happens because Google tracks your search history. Of course, it tracks everyone's search history and recommends ads based on your search history. This is one of the coolest applications of data science, of course. In fact, 35% of Amazon's revenue is generated by product recommendation. And again, the backend data science plays a vital role. And the logic behind the product recommendation is data science. Let me tell you another example. Do you, watch Cloud Direct Heart Attack? Well, again, it's a data science again. Apple Cloud, it uses data science to build a watch that monitors an individual's health. This watch collects data such as a person's heart rate, sleep cycle, breathing rate, even activity levels. Even they are still monitoring your blood pressures as well, and keeps a record of these measures 24/7. And this collected data is then again processed and analyzed to build a model that predicts the risk of a heart attack. See how Apple Cloud uses this data science or leverages the power of data science to implement it in a person's health. How a heart attack could be avoided by the technology. So again, data science is quite important. And again, I would suggest you guys to explore more and more on data sciences. And there are some there is a roadmap. You should explore the roadmap. R and Python is being preferred in data sciences, and some visualization tools and modelings. More and more technical terms are there in data sciences. I would love to give more lectures on this if situation permits. Again, having said that, I would like to talk about the last trend I would like to talk about today, that is cloud computing. Please be very please be listen very carefully. If cloud computing would of course play a vital role in future. See, cloud computing is nothing but the on-demand delivery of IT resources via the internet. Please make note of the term on-demand delivery of IT resources. See, with the pay-as-you-go pricing, instead of buying, owning, or maintaining physical data centers and servers, you can access technology services such as computing power, storage, and databases on as-needed basis from a cloud provider like Amazon Web Services, Google Cloud Platform, Microsoft Azure, Hawaii, and there are more and more competitors are there out there in this world. So you can make use of that. Like, I mean, organizations would definitely move to cloud in future. organizations of every type, besides an industry, are using the cloud for a wide range of uses. The use cases such as data backup, disaster recovery, email backup, virtual desktops, software development and testing. Even they are leveraging this cloud computing to do their bigger data analytics. And even customers are facing or promoting their web applications in cloud nowadays. The whole data science processes are being carried out in the cloud. Big data analytics are being carried out in the cloud, of course. Software developments, testings, everything are being carried out in the cloud nowadays. And of course, organization would prefer to move to cloud in future. For example, healthcare companies are using the cloud to develop more personalized treatments for patients. Financial services companies, banks, insurance organizations. They are using the cloud to power real-time fraud detection and prevention. And video game makers, more and more video game makers are using the cloud to deliver online games to millions of players around the world. Nowadays, we are playing PUBG. It's in the cloud. It's that PUBG is like being deployed in that application is being deployed in the cloud, so that everyone could access it across the world. Netflix, again, I would say it's a streaming application. It's in the cloud. The Netflix platform itself is in the cloud. Having said that, see, this cloud computing in the businesses can become more agile and reduce costs. That's how these organizations would be benefited. That's why they are preferring to move to cloud. They instantly scale the applications and deploy globally in minutes. See, cloud computing gives you instant access to a broad range of technologies, so you can innovate faster and build nearly anything you could imagine. See, from infrastructure services such as compute, storage, and databases. So, Internet of Things, machine learning, data analytics, and much more. What we have discussed before in this session, the other 9 trends, you could deploy these trends and technology services in a matter of minutes in the cloud and get from idea to implementation several orders to magnitude faster than before. This could give you the freedom to experiment and test new ideas to differentiate customer experiences and transform your businesses, such as adding machine learning and to differentiate customer preferences and also to intelligence towards your application in order to personalize your applications or customers' applications and improve their engagement. I'm talking in the business perspective. You should be able to understand in the layman language. I hope so. Of course, you don't need to make large upfront investments in hardware and overpay for capacity. You don't need to make use of those things. Instead, you could trade capital expense for variable expense and only pay for the infrastructure or IT technologies as you consume it. So with cloud computing, you access resources from the cloud in real time as and when they are needed. That's it. As and when they are needed. That's it. You can scale these resources up and down to grow or shrink capacity instantly. Or in other words, you could increase the instances, or you could increase the capacity, or you could downgrade the capacity if it's not needed, as your business needs, as per the business needs, of course. Cloud computing also makes it very easy to expand to new regions and deploy globally in minutes. For example, Amazon Web Services, AWS, is the preferred one across the globe, has infrastructure all over the world. So you are able to deploy your application in multiple physical locations in just a few clicks, putting or hosting applications in closer proximity to end users, reduces latency and improves users' experience as well. Of course, no matter your location, size, or industry, the cloud frees you. Benefits us from managing infrastructure and data centers, so you can focus on what matters most to your business. So these are the 10 trends you have to keep tab on it. You have to explore more. Apart from that, you could also like to tab on the emerging trends. There are a lot more trends it would emerge as time passes, as per the business need, as per different scenarios, as per different conditions. So it's our like sole responsibility to keep tab on it on all the trends, emerging trends, in order to grow, in order to help the businesses as per their requirements. So I think that's it. Apart from that, I would like to give you some tips and tricks. You should always keep tab on these emerging technologies and should explore more, and you should keep your resume building up. Be strong in your business communication, that is, be strong in English. Increase your analytical skills. It's quite needed to understand and leverage all these trends of what we have discussed in this session. So networking, again, be in touch with your seniors or please follow the leaders, market trends, follow in your social media. These trends could be followed. Please be resilient, live your life, enjoy and cherish each and every moment. I wish you all success and have a great journey ahead. Thank you. Any questions? Much appreciated.
Sir, we are honored to have you as our guest. Your generosity and truthfulness are very much appreciated, sir.
See, these are not the only emerging trends. There are a lot and lot more trends are it's quite emerging. I haven't mentioned or I haven't we haven't discussed in today's session. Of course, it's your sole responsibility to keep tabs on it.
Hey, Clayton. It's me, Kumar. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good. How are you?
I'm fine. I'm on behalf of Francis Xavier Engineering College Alumni Association. I thank Mr. Clayton for the wonderful webinar on latest trends in the IT industry. Thank you very much, Clayton. Please do connect with our college frequently. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Clayton. Your session was an awesome session. You talk about Bitcoin, you talked about data analytics, you talked about cloud computing. That was awesome. And one more thing which I just want to mention is, like, in your presentation, you have put your heart, soul, and mind, and your full commitment to explain everything. It was just not a webinar, but you just tried to give your 200% for our students and for all the participants. And we are so proud of you. Thank you so much for coming and participating, and we want to have a very close association with you. And thank you so much once again, and love and regards to all at home, and God bless. And on behalf of Kumar sir, and also on behalf of Franz Xaver Engineering College Alumni Association, we also wish to show gratitude, and also we want to thank you for coming and sharing your expertise and also your valuable time with us, Clayton. Thank you so much. God bless. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks for attending our webinar, Discover the New Trends in Industries. We hope that you found the webinar as more informative, worthwhile, and you enjoyed it. Don't wait for things to happen. Make them happen. Now, I request our coordinator, Mr. S. Iseki Rajavel, Assistant Professor of ECE, to give a vote of thanks. Sir, the passion you have for your job and what you teach is contagious, sir. Over to Iseki Raja, sir.
Distinguished Business Person of the Day, learned professors, participants from various institutions and organizations, student friends, good afternoon, one and all. I feel honored and privileged to propose the vote of thanks for the Alumni Series Webinar 3 by our ECE department. First and foremost, I thank the Lord Almighty for showering His blessings in all our efforts. Next, I delighted to convey our sincere thanks to the speaker of the today's event, Engineer Clayton George Paul, IT analyst, TCS Chennai, who has graced this event his busy schedule. I am sure that today's knowledge sharing is going to be highly impressive and motivating for the participants. Thank you, Clayton. I thank our beloved chairman, Dr. S. Cletus Babu, sir, and our vice chairperson, Mrs. Amini Cletus Babu, ma'am, for their blessings and inspiration. I thank our managing director, Engineer C. Arun Babu, sir, for all this guidance and support extended to us for arranging this event. All of us, are very valuable, brave, has been a great role model and source of inspiration to all of us. Thank you, sir. I thank our respected general manager, development, Dr. K. Jayakumar, sir, for all this guidance and motivation extended to us for arranging this event. I thank our respected principal, Dr. Velmurugan, sir, for all his valuable suggestion and guidance for this event. My special thanks to Mr. Krishnakumar, sir, Professor Alamani, for his continuous support toward this event. I thank you, sir. Finally, I thank our department HOD, Mrs. Professor Deepiska, ma'am, for his constant support and towards this event, and all of your webinar coordinators for coordinating this event in our institution for the integral growth of the student fraternity. Finally, I would also thank all the participants who have joined us across the state from abroad, students and facilities of our department in successfully organizing movement. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Clayton, for sharing your expertise with us. I hope that all our students and almost all the participants would have got benefited out of your session. We feel extremely happy to see you after a very long time. Love and regards to all at home. Thank you so much. Clayton, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.